30 or more, I'm not sure. And at least as I experienced it, computer music started out as this Europe-based art music thing, which is also kind of how electronic music as we now understand it came out. You can impute some of it to film experimenters in the US and Canada in the 30s and 40s, but the real sort of electronic music ball, as we sort of celebrate it now, got started in Europe, largely in France and Germany, and maybe in the late 40s and early 50s. And computer music, of course, or a computer would be a very interesting thing if you were a European composer who likes to think about music as a bunch of manipulations involving sets and numbers. And when I came into the field of computer music in the late 70s, I found out about it at MIT. I was studying computer music with Barry Virko, who taught at MIT, now lives in New Zealand, from New Zealand, who went to a conservatory and learned how to do music as it was supposed to be done in those days, which is to say, done by composers using essentially algorithmic kinds of operations away from any sort of noise-making equipment. And then they would write out scores and they would hand it off to musicians who would put on coats and ties and go out in front of a bunch of people and play along, and then after a while people would clap. This is called the Western art music, or WAM tradition. And this is all well and good, except of course that, a couple of things. One is that computers as a musical instrument don't actually fit terribly well into that tradition. And the other thing is that tradition itself is a very limiting way of thinking about music as a larger entity. And music, of course, is an art, and so there's a larger world of art, what we think of even as music fits inside. And so if you sort of do the Western art music approach to computers, you're first off making a lousy kind of tool for doing Western art music, and second, you're putting yourself in a little niche on purpose. So what I mean by that first statement, which is that computers are computer music as it's practiced, hasn't integrated well into the practice of music, is this. Music really comes from instruments as opposed to scores. And no matter, put it another way, the idea of writing down music in a score had nothing to do with the creation of music as we now listen to it. Music was sung in places that had to get written down in order that the bishops could make sure that the same music was getting sung in all the various parishes that the bishop was controlling. So the idea of writing music down is essentially a way of centralizing control of the Western church. It had nothing to do with the actual creation of music. Right? The creation of music is, you get an idea, you sing it or play it on whatever kind of instrument you have, and that's it. And so if you think of it that way, the score is simply being kind of mnemonic, a way of not forgetting stuff that you're going to come back to later. Of course, it's a very powerful thing to be able to do. It's called storage or memory. But it has nothing to do whatsoever with music performance, which is the fundamental thing that's going on when you make music. And this is what made me think that real-time computer music tools would be interesting. Because, of course, if you're using C sound, which is what I learned when I was a kid, you type numbers into a computer, and then the computer turns them into sound. And obviously, that takes all the fun out of it. It turns it into a tape medium, a way of making fixed stuff. And in fact, you can call that music on fixed media, as opposed to something that is performed. So my entire career in computer music has been about trying to make tools for music performance using computers to mediate sounds and to make instruments be more powerful. And I'm still working on that, although in the last decade or so I've taken a rather different direction doing that, which is this. I've seen that people have taken the real-time tools, which are Super Collider, Max, and PD, and many others, Chuck now, other stuff, and are using it basically as a way of storing stuff. So the huge majority of what you see when you see people playing instruments through computers, at least in a Western art music context, the computer is sitting there sampling stuff or delaying stuff and then playing it back in ways that chirp back at the performer later in sort of hollow mirrors, kind of distorted versions of what the person is playing. And you don't get the impression when you watch someone, say, playing a violin and then having the music swish around your ears or having it come out later, you don't get the impression that it's actually the violinist playing music. And in a way, that actually destroys the traditional music performance to do that. If you want it to feel like someone actually performing the computer, you should see someone doing something, and then you should hear the sound of them doing it, and the computer should appear as a completely transparent thing, like an instrument that that you don't look at and don't call attention to, but simply is the tool that you need to be making the music, which you, the human, are making, the listeners. So, and this is, of course, this is a point of view. This is not like how music ought to be or anything like that, but this is a thing which I feel is missing in the way that people normally do computer music in the conservatory as an environment. So, to break myself out of that, I'm guilty of this, right? Because, of course, I've been in a whole string of productions at EarCom and UCSD, and people always find out that the best way to incorporate a musical instrument into a computer kind of situation is to basically use the computer as a recording tool. So what I'm doing is something totally different from that, which is I'm working on actual musical instruments, and I started with the one that I actually pretend to play a little bit, which is guitar. And I'm not a good guitarist. I'm just kind of a, self-taught, person who had a band when I was a kid and that kind of stuff. So I'm kind of no better guitar than a bunch of you are. And the instruments that I've been interested in, just to sort of frame this, are guitar, percussion, and voice. Because those are the things which are the most, those are the instruments that seem to be the most malleable for messing around with on computers, for each for its own reason. The guitar, the good thing about the guitar is you can get guitars that don't make any sound. So, by which I mean, this thing makes electricity, of course, but if I play, you will hear what's coming out of the speakers, but you won't hear what's coming out of the guitar directly, because it's going to be drowned out by what's going to come out of the speakers. So I can turn this into anything that I want to, in principle. And as a result, whatever technique I or some better guitarist would have is now available as something that the computer can use as the control surface that can be its own instrument, which won't be the guitar, but will be something else. So, actually, just to make a very quick demonstration. So, here's a sound. But this is my E string. You can probably tell it's getting filtered, which is easy to do. But this is not a synthetic sound that you're hearing. It's actually the sound of the string. It's at the wrong octave, and it also has the wrong timbre for long. It has a different timbre from the timbre of the string. Because I'm doing very simple things to it, which are taking the waveform and using it as a lookup into a collection of algorithms that I make, just changing the other waveforms. That's all it is. So what you're getting here is the sound of the string itself. And if I play the string differently, you hear the sound change. Actually, it's really the signal that you're hearing, but it's the signal processed in a way that makes it something different. And there's a huge range of different sounds that I can make with this, just to keep you an idea of the range. Here's one. Sound like a harpsichord, but
Thank you. Thank you.